out the news to everyone. It's a new day, peace has come. Jesus saves, mercy triumphs at the cross. Love has come to rescue us. Jesus saves.
Welcome once again to the People of the Free Gift podcast, where we ground believers in their identity in Christ and equip them to reach out to those caught in religion. We're glad you joined us. We are following along with Jesus as he goes along and he teaches, and we have been the last few weeks in the Sermon on the Mount, which we have said is the most popular sermon that has ever been preached. And so we are continuing on, and this week we're going to be in Matthew's account in Matthew chapter 5, verse 31. But as we've been doing, we're going to be adding details from Luke's account of this very teaching as well. And so if you would turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5, verse 31. And it says, "It has been said, whoever shall put away his wife, let him give for her a writing of divorcement. But I say unto you that whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of fornication, causes her to commit adultery. And whosoever shall marry her that is divorced commits adultery." And what Jesus is getting into, and this is in the series of him saying, "You have heard it said, but I say unto you," both declaring his authority to write and change Scripture, because he is the author of Scripture. He is, in fact, God, but also preaching the law. And we've said that the Sermon on the Mount, the point of it was that we would come to an end of ourselves. We would acknowledge that it's impossible for us to keep this law, not just even an outward action, but Jesus brings it into the heart and into the words of our mouth and into the thoughts and the intents of our heart. And the point is that we're all supposed to tap out and to say, "I need a Savior. I can't do this." And then Jesus embraces us with open arms and says, "I am that Savior. Come to me and I will give you rest." And when it came to this particular issue, this was the issue of divorcement and marriage. And the law in Moses' day was split. It said, if a wife has found no grace in her husband's eyes. And this comes from Deuteronomy 24, verses 1 through 4. And it says this: "When a man has taken a wife and married her, and it come to pass that she find no favor in his eyes, because he has found some uncleanness in her, then let him write her a bill of divorcement and give it in her hand and send her out of the house. And when she has departed out of his house, she may go and be another man's wife. And if the latter husband hate her and write her a bill of divorcement and give it in her hand and sends her out of his house, or if the latter husband die, which took her to be his wife, her former husband, which sent her away, may not take her again to be his wife. After that, she is defiled, for that is abomination before the Lord. And you shall not cause the land to sin, which the Lord thy God gives thee for an inheritance." And so the original law in Moses' day said this, and I find it interesting, and we're going to find that there's some hidden grace in the midst of the law that Jesus is preaching as we go through this particular section today. But the way that it's worded is, if a wife has found no grace in her husband's eyes, and it's because he has found some uncleanness in her. And this really gets to the heart of marriage, yes, to the heart of the gospel. And what God's intent for marriage is that we would show grace, husband to wife to husband, with one another. No human being is perfect. No one is going to be completely clean in the sight of each other or in the sight of God. And when that happens, how you react to it as a spouse is vitally important. And the way that it's worded, I find, is really interesting, because it shows that the fault is on the husband. Or it's on the wife. It's on the partner. Now, in those days, the husband had all the rights. And so the fault would be on the husband, because his fault is that he has no grace to extend to his wife. And if that's the case, because he's found uncleanness in her, then, and he has no grace, then Moses allowed, Jesus would say, because of the hardness of their hearts, he is going to allow them to write a certificate of divorce. But what I find interesting is the grace that's extended by God to the spouse. In that, if your husband has no grace for you, I will have grace for you on you. And you are released. You are free. When the wife is released, she may become another man's wife. God is making provision for her to have the marriage that she desires and the way out of a marriage in which is abusive and in which is not filled with grace. And then once the wife is released, the husband cannot have her back. She is free. She is released to be another man's wife. And when we were going through Hebrews and Galatians and talking about our relationship to the law, this becomes really important, because when we die to the law, when we die with Christ, the moment we accept him, we die to the law, which sets us free to become the spouse of another. And that one we marry is Christ. And so all of this we're going to see is a picture. God doesn't do things by accident. Every single one of these things we're going to find is a picture of his relationship with us. Now, what you need to understand as well is what this had become in Jesus' day. This whole thing of writing a certificate of divorce became a point of controversy. And there was basically split between two primary rabbis and schools of thought on this issue. One was the school of Shammai, which said, and it was pretty conservative, that unchastity before or after marriage was the uncleanness that a husband would be able to find in his wife and be able to grant her a certificate of divorce. So in other words, the uncleanness would be specific, that she has sinned sexually, she has violated the covenant of their marriage in that way, either before or after. And I'm presumably it would be hidden knowledge of what she had done before they had gotten married. But in that case, Shammai says, you are free to get a divorce. And Hillel, who was the other prominent rabbi, took the other extreme, and that is anything that made the wife untasteful. So basically, the classic one, I guess, in the Jewish writings was, if a wife burns her husband's toast, then he would be free to get a certificate of divorce. Now, you could see the kind of bondage that would put women in if that's the kind of mindset that you go into marriage with. That basically, the wife is the slave of the husband. She must be perfect and pleasing at all times. And whatever the husband desires, it is his will or the highway, basically. And so that's what they were coming to Jesus basically with. The questions that they asked about marriage had to do with this. What do we have to put up with, basically, Jesus, when it comes to our wives? What do we have to put up with? And Jesus comes at them and illustrates the point of marriage. You see, the point of marriage wasn't having divorce in mind at all. God created man. He created woman from man's side, and he made them equals, complements of one another. And the idea is that we should be putting each other first in the marriage, and that we should be serving one another as we serve Christ. And in doing so, his intent was that we would be a picture of Christ and his church. It says that husbands are to love their wives as Christ left the church and gave himself up for her, that we're to wash her with the water of the word, that we are to be a model of grace and sacrifice and love to our wives. And likewise, the wives are to be submissive to their husbands, and they are to be a picture of the church's relationship with Jesus. But that's not the only model that marriage gives to the watching and waiting world. God also intended marriage to be a picture of the very nature of God, in the fact that he is one God in three persons. That we are, the husband and wife, it says, are to become one flesh. That you have two persons who become one flesh. And in doing so, the husband and wife relationship in marriage is supposed to be a model of complete unity within complexity, within two individuals who are becoming one. And that's a humbling thing. That is a high calling and responsibility. And I would submit to you that all of our relationships reflect part of the nature of God and our relationship with him, but all of our relationships require grace, forgiveness, and sacrifice, all of which conform us into the image of Christ. And that's why I find it so fascinating that even in Deuteronomy, the way that it was worded was that if the husband has no grace for his wife, then he can send her away and she will be free. So going on to verse 33, and it says, again, you have heard that it has been said by them of old time, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform unto the Lord your oaths. But I say unto you, swear not at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by earth, for it is this footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Neither shall you swear by your head, because you can't make one hair white or black, but let your communication be yes, yes, no, no. For whosoever or whatsoever is more than these comes of evil. And when it comes to the idea of making promises and oaths and swearing and pledging, this was a major part of, you know, the way that religion had become in the Jewish world. They would make their covenants before God, and they would make these pronounced oaths, and they would go through these ceremonies. And Jesus comes on the scene and says, no, your word should be your word. And it should be simple and to the point. In other words, less is more. When you're communicating about your relationship with God, or you're communicating with God, less is more. And I want to say this. Have you ever noticed that those who talk more do less? Have you ever noticed that those who talk more do less? In other words, that the more that somebody seems passionate about a very particular thing, the more that they post on Facebook, the more that they rant and rave about a particular thing, the more that they're affiliated with different organizations that might support different things, and that becomes the thing that they're known for in their life and all that kind of stuff. Have you ever noticed that the more that they talk, the less that they do? Have you ever noticed that those who set themselves on a platform of being better than others and speaking down to others on some issue tend to fall in that very area? And I don't know about you, but I can think of so many names, both religious and political, as well as in the sports world, in the in Hollywood. I can think of so many names of people who have gotten to highest heights and then fallen down with a crash. And oftentimes when you look at them and the platform on which they became popular, or the one in which they based their reputation,
it seems like it so often becomes the very platform that they fall from. And you have to wonder sometimes, are they talking as much as they're talking so that they can convince themselves or maybe take others' eyes off of things that they're doing? Is it the very sins that they struggle with that make them so passionate about those issues? And the other thing that I just have to point out is that your promises to God are worthless. Sometimes we tend to put the people who say that, you know, God, if you get me out of this, and then I'll devote my life to you, and they actually follow through, we actually tend to put them on a higher pedestal. But our promises to God are actually worthless, because we do not have the ability ultimately to carry through on our word. The promises that some would make that they're going to keep their oaths before God is meaningless, because they never do. And we've said this before as we were going through this, that I don't care who you are or what your standards are, I promise you and guarantee you that you do not keep and live up to your own standards. So whatever promises you're tempted to make before God, I want to encourage you to not. I want to encourage you to not make your relationship with God into a huge ceremonial thing. And so going on to verse 38, he says, "You have heard that it has been said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I say unto you, that you resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if any man will sue you and take away your coat, let him have your cloak also. And whosoever shall compel you to go a mile, go with him too. Give to him that asks you, and from him that would borrow of you, do not turn him away. From him that takes away your goods, do not seek them back. And as you would that men do to you, do also to them likewise. You have heard that it has been said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you, and pray for them that spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be children of your Father which is in heaven." And the big principle I see in this section is to really embrace and believe that vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. So often, we want justice. We cry out for justice and we scream, unfair, unfair. But the truth of the matter is that if we really think about it, we don't want justice. You should never ask for justice, because justice is what will end you up with separation from God, will end you up in paying the penalty for your own sins, rather than the mercy of God that says that you will not get what you deserve, and furthermore, even the grace of God, which says that you will get what you don't deserve. And Jesus lived this one out. Jesus wasn't just talking like we talked about just a second ago. Jesus lived out and he backed up what he was saying and what he was preaching. He didn't just preach law, he lived the law. And when he was crucified, they stole his garments and gambled over them. They beat him with their fists, scourged him, and placed a crown of thorns on his head. They accused him falsely, and they killed an innocent man. The question is, do you believe that God is just? Do you believe that God ultimately will have everything fall exactly as it's supposed to fall? We may question the justice of man. We may question the justice of our country. We may question the justice of our family or a situation. But the question is not what we believe about people and their ability to carry out justice. The question really goes further. And what do we believe about God and His ability to carry out justice? Here's the reality about what the Bible says about what happens when we step in and we start taking vengeance into our own hands rather than trusting God, just as Jesus did. When it says that he was accused falsely, yet he opened not his mouth, but instead he entrusted himself to him who commits justice and who in whom justice resides. Here's what happens when we step in. Jesus says, would say, you have received your reward. See, the reality is we can say until we're blue in the face that we want what God wants. But the truth of the matter is when we're wronged and we step in and we take the place that God is supposed to have, then we have received our reward. We have communicated to God and to others as our witnesses of what we really actually want. Do we want God to deliver justice or do we want to deliver justice? The truth of the matter is that justice is stunted when we actually step in, because whatever version of justice that you think you're able to measure out to make the situation fair, I guarantee you that God's is better. So the justice that would have been measured out in that circumstance, on that individual, and in your life, you have now shown that God, hey, I got this, I can handle this, I'm going to step in, I'm going to take matters into my own hands. And in the process, you miss out on your reward that would have come from God measuring out justice, but you also stop God from being able to intervene in that person's life because you have delivered justice on his behalf. And instead, what we are encouraged to do in scriptures is that we're actually supposed to do good for those who hate us. We're supposed to pray for those who persecute us. We're supposed to go to bat as another sinful human being on their behalf and asking God to bring justice, but also ultimately desiring that he would show mercy. And in the process, we may be adding to Jesus' payment for that sin. We don't think about it this way, but when we step in, we deliver justice and we demand that things be made right, what we're actually doing is Jesus died for that sin. And so justice has been measured out for that sin. If that person comes to faith in Jesus Christ, then what you've actually done when you step in and demand justice is you've actually added to what Jesus has done on the cross. And I know that may be hard to really sink in, but the truth of the matter is that's exactly what we're doing. We're saying with our actions and possibly with our words that what Jesus has done on the cross is not sufficient. That if he's died for that sin, that's not sufficient. What God wants to do to deliver justice in that situation is not sufficient. I must step in and deliver justice. And so Jesus would encourage us that if we're feeling like we need to step in and deliver justice, on our own behalf and make things right and fair and just, then we're missing the point of the gospel, that that is a sign that we are committing a work of the flesh rather than the fruit of the Spirit. That is not allowing Him to live His life out through us. That is stepping in and quenching the Spirit and grieving the Spirit and stepping in and doing what He has called us not to do. Now, what God's justice allows us to do, if we will commit ourselves to Him who judges justly, just like Jesus did, what God's justice allows us to do is to not get revenge. It allows us to not get revenge. It allows us to go the extra mile, which, by the way, that's where that phrase comes from. It allows us to go the extra mile. It allows us to err on the side of generosity, and it allows us to pray and desire good for those who mistreat us. Exactly what Jesus is calling us to do, all of those things and our ability to do those or not do those things are a symptom of us demanding our justice or allowing God to administer justice on our behalf. We take the posture of the fellow sinner who has been saved by grace and desires the same for this individual. And it allows God to be the judge or the extender of mercy through the justice of His Son's shed blood. And it allows us to live His life out through us in generosity, in advocating for our enemies, in going the extra mile, and not getting revenge. Verse 45, for He makes His sun to rise on the evil and on the good. He sends His rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors and sinners the same? And if you greet your brothers only, what do you have more than others? Do not even the tax collectors and sinners the same? And if you lend to them, you hope to receive repayment from, what grace have you? For sinners also lend to sinners, to receive as much again, but love your enemies, and do good, and lend, hoping for nothing again, and your reward will be great, and you shall be the children of the Highest. For He is kind to the unthankful and to the evil. Be therefore merciful, as your Father also is merciful. Be therefore perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. This is really where grace comes in. And it was amazing what I was able to find below the surface in this passage. You see, what Jesus is saying is that grace isn't just about salvation. Grace is extended by God to all. And there's a couple of ways in which He points to. And He says that before salvation, even when somebody is an enemy of God, He allows the sun to rise on all and the rain to fall on all. In doing so, He is the provider for our basic needs as human beings, His creation. He is kind to the unthankful and to the evil. And we're reminded by Paul, it's the kindness of the Lord that leads us to repentance. So why do we give? And Jesus challenges us on this. Why do we give? Why do we serve? Why are we generous or not generous? Is it because they deserve it? Do we only give when we feel like that person deserves it? Do we give because of what we'll get out of it, the good feelings, or possibly even the rewards that you feel like you're going to get from God? Or if I give, then God will bless me financially, and that's why I'm giving. Or are we giving the way that God gives, which is grace, unmerited favor? You give what is not deserved. Are we giving the way that God gives? Or are we giving for our own glory or so that we'll look good in front of others? Or maybe because we feel like we have to. And I find it interesting, particularly this phrase in Luke. He says, "What thank have you?" And some of you have that in your translations. And I find it interesting because Luke said, "What thank have you?" And Matthew says, "What reward have you?" And when I looked at that word, because they use different words, I wanted to see what the Greek words were. And what I found was when Luke says thank, the word is charis, which is the Greek word for grace. Literally, he's saying, "What grace have you? If you lend only to those who can repay you, what grace have you? If you greet only those who will greet you back, what grace have you?" And what he's asking is basically to ask the question, what are you doing to those who don't deserve it? You see, everything that Jesus points to in this passage is based off of the model of God, who sends the rain on the just and the unjust, who loves his enemy so much that he dies on a cross as a complete payment for their sins, not because they deserve it, not because they love him back, or that all of them ever will. He does it because he loves them. He does it because he shows his grace to them. And so the question that comes back to us is, if you only do things for people who do you think deserve it, or people who you think will be able to do it back for you, then what grace have you? And I find it interesting that this language of grace gets connected with the language of reward. And we've talked about this before, how it says that we should not let anybody steal our reward. There will be some who suffer loss at the judgment seat of Christ. Paul would say, "My crown is laid up for me." Jesus referred to the Pharisees, saying they have abstained from their reward. God desires to give you the kingdom, and the kingdom must be received as a little child. But now we have this other passage that says that the language of reward and the language of grace is the same thing. What reward have you? Is really connected to what grace have you. What grace in showing undeserved favor to others, which is only possible if you allow the grace of God to be manifested through you to others. The way that we live out grace, Jesus would say, is that we greet and we welcome all. We are generous with all. We love all, even our enemies and those who do not treat us well, which doesn't mean that we're doormats. There is discernment that's involved, but we do show love even to our enemies, and we show mercy to all. And so if you're here, as I do every week, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, I want to offer that to you right now. And it's between you and him in your own words from where you're sitting. It's as simple as this, to say, "Lord Jesus, I am a sinner. But I believe that you died on the cross and rose again from the dead as a payment for my sins. And so I ask you to forgive me of my sins, change me from the inside out. I want to follow you all the days of my life." And if it's not the words that save you, it's the belief in your heart that's manifested in the words. And if you do that, I promise you, he is faithful and he will come through. He will fulfill his end. We encourage you to let somebody know so that we can give you the tools that you'll need as you start your journey with him, and that we can encourage you on that. But if you're here and you're a believer in Jesus Christ, I just want to encourage you as Jesus would, to live a life of grace. To not look around you and cast judgment, to not try and get justice, but that rather you would seek his grace and that you would extend his grace. That you would look not for those who deserve it, not for those who can pay you back, but that you would be looking for the opportunities that he's giving you, he's leading you into, in which you can give the undeserved, unmerited favor of God, whether through generosity, a simple greeting, loving your enemies, or forgiving those who don't deserve to be forgiven. So, Lord, I just pray that you would bring your blessing upon each one here, Lord, that you would speak to each one. I pray, Father, for wherever they're listening, whether here or on the internet, I pray, Father, that you would meet them exactly where they are. I pray, Father, that you would guide us, instruct us, Lord, fill us with your grace and with your love and with your compassion and peace and joy, Lord. May we be able to extend that grace to all. And may we not show partiality as you show partiality. Lord, we acknowledge our humanness in this, that we are unable to be perfect as you, our Heavenly Father, are perfect. And so we do tap out and we ask for your grace. And as we receive that same grace, you send us out to extend it to others. And I pray, Father, you give us those opportunities to do that. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Jesus said, "Freely you have received, freely give." And so if you go to www.peopleofthefreegift.com, you can access all of our articles, all of our videos, all of our podcasts, and everything else our ministry has to offer completely for free. For those who are in a position who are led of the Lord, we do appreciate your donations, and you can do so through that same website. We'd love to connect with you, and so you can catch up with us through the website, through Facebook, through Twitter, Google+, and Pinterest. And we'd love to hear your ideas, your comments, your questions for future podcasts.
Hope is here. What a joyful noise we'll make as we join with him.